Hello, board gamers. Today I'm going to be playing through a round or two of Madeira. I've always been surprised that there have been so few videos and posts in the Madeira forum here on Board Game Geek, and I guess I've attributed that maybe to one of two possible reasons. People just thinking this game is overwhelmingly complicated. Which, while it's heavy, I wouldn't call it overwhelmingly complicated. I was certainly one of those people that was scared all away from it for quite some time. But the truth is, once you start playing the game, you immediately realize, this really isn't that complicated at all. It's certainly not complicated to learn. Of course, learning to play very well is a whole different story, but I never succeeded very well at that. The other reason I think might be that people think this game is out of print. Some of the prices for this board game here in the States are ridiculously high. The game is not out of print. You can't buy it easily within the United States, but you can certainly buy it from the publisher's website, whatsyourgame.eu. In fact, if you go to their website, you can buy the base game and the expansion, which was Madeira Ambassadors, for actually what I considered an incredibly reasonable price, which is 50 euros, which in the United States currency at the current exchange rate is about $57. And that includes shipping. So, order it from What's Your Game if you want it. It'll get there, get to you probably in 7 to 10 days, and bargain price. I mean, I was assuming, I was going to find out it was $50-some and then $20 for shipping. Nope, they include the shipping. It's really a bargain. Today I'm going to be doing a playthrough, obviously not using my board game components, but using the program I wrote. Anybody who's watched any of my playthrough videos know I enjoy doing this. I enjoy programming some of my favorite games, and it certainly makes video presentations like this much easier for me instead of having to move the camera around and film board game components moving all about. So it's sort of like watching a Vassal module, if you will, although albeit this one's a little more automated. As you'll find out. I should just include this real quick disclaimer that I always include, and that is that I write these programs for my own enjoyment. They're not for sale. I don't give them away. I don't do anything. They're just for me. So please don't ask. If you do ask, I'll just politely decline to give you a copy. Today is all about learning how to play Madeira and watching it played for, say, a round or two. I don't think it's necessary to play the whole game, but I will give you an idea of how the game changes a little bit from round to round. And we'll go through really just about everything you need to know to play this game. Today I'm going to be doing a two-player run-through of blue versus red, and I am going to use the expansion because it doesn't really add that much. In fact, it's almost transparent. I'm also going to be using the micro expansion, which is hard to find. It was originally published. It was called Madeira Harvester. It was originally published, I think, in Spielbox magazine, and it's really hard to find unless you happen to get it in a trade or something like that. It's not something that you can easily track down. However, it's only one tile, and an image of the tile is out here on Board Game Geek, so you could very easily mock it up on a piece of cardboard. And I would encourage you to do that because it really adds some spice to the game. And I'll point that out when we get to it. Okay. Let me click OK. Let me get the game underway here. And then I'm going to start over here by just talking about the various kinds of things you track in the game. So I'm on the right-hand side here in my little scoreboard area. And obviously we're tracking the score, no surprise there. Each player in the game starts with 12 workers. But during the setup, two of those workers immediately get placed in an area called the City Watch, which is up here in the top left-hand corner, right here behind this message. You can see that there are two blue workers here in the City Watch already, and there are two red workers here in the City Watch. That leaves 10 workers for each player in the supply over here on the right-hand side again. Also, each player starts off the game with 6 ships in their supply. Each player essentially starts off the game with 7 money, $7, 7 reals, actually, as it's referred to in Madeira currency. The first player certainly gets $7, everybody else gets $7, but the second player, after the starting player, gets an extra dollar, which is not uncommon in games like this, to compensate for going second. If you're playing a 3 or 4 player game, the third player would start with $9, and the fourth player would start with $10. I'm just going to use dollars to make it easy when I'm referring to money here. Okay, so we've got the starting player, which is red, starting with $7, blue starting with $8. Pirates are not pirates in the sense of guys with eye patches and parrots on their shoulders. Pirates in this game are more like piracy. It's more like, well, look, I'm not even going to go into an explanation of what, because there are lots of theories about what it refers to. Suffice it to say that pirates in this game are a source of negative points. So you don't really want to get them, but it is rather hard to avoid them. And it is easy to mitigate them or get rid of them. So, relatively easy. So I'll talk more about pirates as we go along. And in fact, I'm going to talk more about all these different things as we go along. So never fear. Bread serves, bread's primary function is to feed your workers at the end of every round. There are 5 rounds in the game, and at the end of every round, one of the things you have to do during what's called the maintenance phase is feed your workers. That's simply a way to manage, to prevent players from just simply taking all their workers and just moving them onto the board. There's got to be a cost to having your workers in play as opposed to sitting in your supply. So you have to feed each worker 1 bread at the end of the round, although that is typically reduced, and we'll talk about that when we get to the maintenance phase at the end of the round. But bread is primarily used to feed workers. It has a secondary function, and that is to take actions, and that will come up shortly as I talk about actions. Wood is primarily used to launch ships and for the upkeep of ships, also during the maintenance phase. You need 1 wood to launch a ship from your supply onto the board, and then at the end of every round, you'll be paying 1 wood for each of your ships that are on the board. Once ships have been launched, well, workers do have a way to come back into your supply, but once ships are launched and leave your supply, they're on the board for the rest of the game. There's no way to get ships back into your supply. The secondary reason for having wood is to pay for guild favors, which are over here. We'll obviously be talking more about that shortly. You'll see that any guild favors in this column cost 2 wood. These cost 3 wood, 4 wood, and 5 wood. Let me turn that off. Okay, then we have the 3 main goods in the game, wheat, sugar, and wine, or grapes. Without going into too much depth of the history of Madeira, and I'm no history expert, but as it goes, when Madeira was first came to be, it started off as a wheat-producing island. This was, I guess, in the 1400s, 1500s. And eventually the wheat market dried up, so they had to come up with some other ideas. So they converted most of their fields to sugarcane fields and sold sugarcane for a long time. They were the sugarcane producing island. Eventually that didn't work out so well, so they then switched over to grapes, to wine. And, of course, to this day, that's what Madeira is known for, the Madeira wine. So you will see over the course of the game that wheat fields will in fact convert to sugarcane, and then later on in the game, sugarcane fields will convert to wine or grapes, as I said. I will probably just refer to sugarcane as sugar, simply to make things easier for the rest of the game. So we have wheat, sugar, and wine as the three main goods, but there's also bread and wood. Bread to mostly pay ducks feed workers, bread mostly to pay for ships. And of course, the negative points in the form of pirates. Okay, a lot of what scares people away from this game is the fact that the board can be a little overwhelming, to say the least. But I'm just going to break it down into its constituent components, and that should help make things easier. Here we have the main island of Madeira, and over here we have the smaller island of Madeira. Now, there are obviously even smaller islands, these little tiny islands sticking out from the sides and the edges. We're only going to be talking about in this game the main island and the smaller island, as I'll refer to them. And the smaller island is referred to in the game as Region 1. The southern coast of Madeira, the main island, is referred to as Region 2, and the northern coast is referred to as Region 3. You'll see that Region 1 consists of these four fields, this one producing wine or grapes. Again, I'm just going to use wine instead of constantly flipping back and forth between wine and grapes. So wine here, over here we have wheat. Here we have a field that is wheat that will eventually convert to sugar, as you can see in this icon. However, this is currently covered by wood, meaning that the only way to get to the wheat is to first clear the field of wood, and there's one wood tile here, and then once that wood tile's gone, then you can then you'll have a wheat field, and then eventually that wheat field will get converted to sugar. Over here we have a sugar field that is waiting to get converted to wine, but it's currently covered by one wood tile as well. In the game, I should point out, there are some numbers here, you can barely read them, but in a two-player game, you're instructed to cover these areas here with one wood tile. In a two-player game, you cover them with two wood tiles. In a two-player game, you cover them with one. A three-player game, you cover them with two. And a four-player game, you cover them with three. So all that scale based on the number of players. Down here in the southern coast, we have a wheat field, a wine field, again another tile of wood that's covering a wine field. Over here we have two tiles of wood, as indicated by this two here, covering this wheat field, which will eventually convert to sugar, and four wood covering a sugar field, eventually converting to wine. In the northern coast, sugar, wheat, wood covering sugar, wood covering wheat, and up here, wood covering wine. In the center of the main island, there is this area called the King's Forest, which is a source of wood. It is not associated with Region 2 or Region 3. It's its own little region here in the center of the island. And it's used as a source of wood if you start running out of wood in these other fields, as you start clearing these fields. Okay, surrounding the islands are five buildings. This one, well, actually, I'm going to start up here. I'm going to call this one number one. This one's going to be number two. So these two are associated with Region 3. Over here, I'm going to call this one Building 3, which is associated with Region 1, and then Buildings 4 and 5 associated with Region 2. During the game, you will see in some sense that these are numbered, in fact, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in clockwise order, but during another part of the game, in fact, they're numbered in reverse order, this one being 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We'll talk about that when the time comes. For now, just imagine there's a building here. Each one of these are a separate building, the top half of which that can be covered by a character tile, and in fact will be covered by a character tile, and the bottom half, which is a separate building action, which is used at a different time during the game. Let me interject here that I did say earlier that there are five rounds to the game. Each round consists of five phases. Phases A, B, C, D, and E. And we'll break all that down as when we start playing the game as well. Let's only divert your attention down here to the bottom left corner. These are three different cities. I'm just going to refer to them as the Bread City, right here. The Money City, which is a good place to go if you are in need of money. And the Wood City, a good place to go if you're in need of wood. You'll see that each city consists of one, two, three, four city spots, the rightmost of which is currently occupied by a neutral citizen or a neutral worker. And in my program, I color that box gray, but in fact, during the game, I think you're playing with white tokens. Yeah, they're white. I just make it gray here to make it easier to see. So four city spots making up each city. However, as these guild favors disappear over the course of the game, and in a two-player game, not many of them are going to disappear. They're not used that heavily. But behind each one of these guild tiles is another two city spots. So in fact, if you clear a city of all of its guild favors, there are a total of 12 city spots available. And when you're talking about these city spots and whether or not a particular spot is occupied by one of your workers, there are three things you have to consider. Do you have a presence in the city? Meaning, do you have at least one worker in one of the city spots? Secondly, do you have a majority in the city, more workers than anybody else? And the other thing that's important is the position in the city. Are you in the leftmost city spot, rightmost city spot, in the middle, whatever? So we'll talk more about positioning and presence and majority as the game goes on. For now, just imagine that each one of these cities consists of 12 little city spots where a worker can reside. But the rightmost city spot here, while all the other ones are covered by these guild favors, the rightmost of each of the four city spots that make up a city currently is covered or occupied by a neutral citizen. That's the case regardless of the number of players. These neutral citizens are always on the board from the get-go, no matter how many players you're playing with. Down here, over here in the bottom right-hand corner, this is called the market route area of the game. This is where ships can go to sell goods, to sell wheat, sugar, wine, for money, and for earning prestige points. So this is called the market area where ships go, and this is just above it is called the colony area, another place where ships can go off to distant colonies to sell Madeira wine in exchange for favors of the crown, favors of the king. Workers can also come into these colony landing spots where you could earn points for the number of ships that are in that particular colony area. Each one of these you can see that the colony area is divided into three different colonies, and the market route area is divided into three different market routes. Wheat, sugar, and wine. And up here, I'm simply going to refer to these as colony 1, 2, and 3. We will talk more about this area called the windmill at a different point during this playthrough. And I also referred to this area here called the City Watch. Otherwise, I think we pretty much talked about everything. This little thing I've added in the game over here in the top left corner simply is a reminder that at any time during the game, you can exchange two goods for one of some other good. You can exchange two wheat for a sugar or two wine for one wheat or whatever the case may be. So you can always pretty much do that for most of the game. That ability is there for you. This little graphic above that is a reminder about how pirates work. at the end of the game, it's not so much that you lose a certain number of points based on the number of pirates that you have, but rather the player with the most pirates loses 16 points flat out. The player with the second most number of pirates, pirate tokens or counters, loses 8 points. Then the third player would lose 4, and the fourth player would lose 2. If you don't have any pirates at the end of the game, you're fortunate, you don't lose any points. You can also lose points by having too many pirates over and above 20. For every pirate that you have that's over and above 20, you lose an additional point. So, let's just, again, suffice it to say that while pirates can sometimes be difficult to avoid and that you'll probably have to take them on, you can find ways to get rid of them during the game if you want to. And you don't want to be stuck, because if you happen to have one pirate and nobody else has any pirates at the end of the game, you're going to lose 16 points, whether you have one pirate, 5, 10, or 15. But as I said, if you go over 20, you're going to start losing additional points, so one by one. Okay, we talked about the resources in the game. We talked about all the different parts of the board. Each part of the board, by the way, corresponds to a way of scoring points in the game. Now, there are lots of ways to earn little points here and a few points there, but there is one way to earn the majority of your points, and that is by fulfilling the requests of the king, or what are called king's requests in the game, or requests of the crowns, or crowns requests, whatever it is. I can't remember the exact verbiage. At the end of rounds 1, 3, and 5 in this 5-player game, you have to see whatever points you can earn for these king's requests, and then surrender some number of them. At the end of round 1, you have to score one king's request. So you pick one of the king's requests you have, and at the end of round 1, you're going to have 2 to choose from. You're going to pick one of those, score whatever points you can, and then discard it. At the end of round 3, by the time round 3 comes around, you're going to have 3 king's requests to choose from, 2 of which at the end of round 3 have to be surrendered, scored, and then surrendered. And at the end of round 5, you're going to have 3 king's requests again in your possession, but all 3 of those at that time have to be scored and surrender. So over the course of the game, you're going to be collecting 6 king's requests, and by the time the game's over, all 6 of those are going to be discarded and scored. So that's picking which king's requests you want to have in your possession at some any point during the game, and how much you can earn from them is a large part of playing this game. One of the king's requests refers to having a majority or a presence in the city. So that's one of the king's requests. Another king's request refers to having some series of these guild favors in such a way that you have represented each of the 4 different guilds in the game. And for simplicity's sake, I'm simply going to say there's a white guild, there's a red guild, there's a green guild, and there's a purple or a violet guild. And while I'm talking about guilds, let me just quickly say that this is where the main Ambassador's expansion comes into play. The base game of Madeira comes with 12 guild favors, 3 in each of the 4 different colored guilds. You take those guild favors, you shuffle them up, and you place them down here in the city area, and you can see there are 12 guild favors, 12 spots. When you buy the Ambassador expansion, you're basically just getting 4 more guild favors, 1 in each of the various colored guilds. And instead of shuffling all those 16 up, you separate them first by guild. So you've got 4 white guilds and 4 red guilds, 4 green, 4 purple. You randomly remove 1 from each of those guilds, and then you shuffle up the remaining 12, and that's what you're left with. So you always want to ensure that this city area down here is represented equally by each of the 4 guilds. So you'll see that here I have 1, 2, three white guilds, and in fact, this particular guild favor is one of the newer ones from the Ambassador expansion. Then I have 1, 2, 3 greens, 3 reds, and 1, 2, 3, the color was a little bit off on that one. Maybe that's from the, she's from the Ambassador's expansion as well. Coloring's a little different, but basically purple. Okay, I was talking about King's Request. So we've got having a presence or a majority in a city is one way to earn points, and that's referred to over here by these numbers. For example, if you had a majority in City 1, you could get 10 points. But if you didn't have a majority and you only had a presence, you could get 7 points, a consolation prize. Obviously, as you can see here, it's better to have a majority in City 3, the Wood City. But if you can't have a majority, it's better to have a presence in City 1, because that earns 7 points as opposed to 6 or 5 in the other two cities. Another way to score points via King's Requests is by having a market route King's Requests. So it's not actually called a market route. I don't remember exactly what it's called, but you can score for having up to 3 ships in the market route area down here. Another one is to score for having as many as 3 ships in the colony area. There are a total of 5 King's Requests: the colony, the market, the city majority, the guild favors, and simply trading in money for points. That one's called the Wealth of the Nations. When you start the game, so now we're going to actually talk about playing the game. And I will put in the show notes for this video, I will have indexed timestamps where you can jump around to various parts of the game. So here we are starting the setup of the game. And one of the first things you do is, in fact, I think it is the first thing you do after basically setting up the board, is shuffling 4 starting King's Requests and then randomly handing one out to each player. So the blue player here randomly got dealt this King's Request, which is the one that I talked about just a few seconds ago, where you can trade in dollars, send money back to the crown in exchange for prestige points, up 1 point per dollar, up to a maximum of 15 points for $15. So blue was dealt that one. Red, on the other hand, was dealt this one, the Expeditions King's Request, which earns points for having ships in this colony area. Everything is traced back to a certain icon. So this globe here is the globe that represents the colonies, and this treasure chest looking thing here, here, and here refers to the market routes part of the game. So in fact, the 4 different King's Requests are, pardon me, I have to turn this off. There's a dehumidifier in the room. There are 4 different starting King's Requests. The one that pays money, points for money. This one, the Expeditions. There's a Market King's Request. And there's a starting City King's Request. One of the 4 is not the guild. That is not a starting request. Each one of these 4 starting requests has a number of crowns on the back of it, and the player who gets a request that has the most crowns on the back is the starting player. So as you can deduce, this red player here got the Expeditions, and that happens to have more crowns on the back of it than this Wealth of the Nations tile that the blue player got. That only has 1 crown on the back. So that's how you determine who the starting player is. And then from that point on, you simply go clockwise around the board, because it doesn't take long for the starting player to change. The turn order changes over the course of the round. Then, the next step before the big game begins is you go in reverse turn order. And that's why blue, as you can see here, is going first. In reverse turn order, each player starts by taking one of the workers from their supply, one of the 10 workers they have remaining in their supply, and placing it in one of the three cities. Now, so it's the blue player's turn. The blue player has to take a worker and place it either in the wood city, in one of these city spots that are empty, in the wood city, the money city, or the bread city. Well, one piece of logic here is that, well, since blue is going for points for money, maybe it makes sense to put a worker in the money city as a source of funds. And that, in fact, could be one viable strategy. However, wood in this game, as I said earlier, is used to build ships. And then ships can sail to this market route area. And when you sell wheat and sugar and wine, you sell it for money, profit. As you can see here, 1, 2, 3, or 4 wheat earns you $3, $6, $9, or $12. So this is a source of money as well. And because of that, I think I am going to start by having the blue player put a worker in this city spot next to the neutral citizen. Remember, farther right is better, although at this point, the neutral citizen has an edge over the blue player's worker because it's farther right, farther to the right. But I'm going to put a worker here for blue. Okay. Now, while red has to find an empty city spot to place one of its workers, it can be in any of the three cities. It just can't be in a city spot that's currently occupied by a worker, by a neutral citizen, or in this case, the blue player's worker. Remember the red player's king's request? They want to get as many ships out to the colony area. So they need wood to build ships as well. So for that reason, they too are going to place a worker in the wood city right next to the blue worker. Now we go back in reverse turn order, and each player in that order has to place down two of their workers in two fields, in either on the main island or the smaller island. However, the two workers they put down have to be in different fields, and they have to be in different regions as well. So blue player here, for example, could put a worker in one of the fields in region 3 and then could put a worker, say, in a field in region 1. The red player will then have to put down two workers as well, but they have to go in different fields and in different regions. But let me go through an example and it'll be much more clear. So let's say blue, remember, wants to get wood in order to build their ships and get some money. So one place, a good place for them to go is over here where they can get a source of 4 pieces of wood. So they're going to place a worker here, their first one. Now, their second worker can't go in region 2. It's got to go in a field in a different region. And we don't count the King's Forest. That's not part of region 1, 2, or 3. So they, the other blue worker has to go either go up here or over here. And again, because I want to have a source of wood, I am going to, well, actually, no way. We're getting wood from here. So thinking ahead, maybe I'm going to want to sell sugar because that makes a pretty nice profit. And also grapes. I could go over here for grapes. But for now, I think I'm just going to put myself down to this sugar field in region 3. Okay, so that's that. Now, the red player has to do the same thing. They have to put down 2 workers. They can go in the same region as the blue player. They just can't go in the same field as the blue player. So the red player wants to also have a source of wood. So they're going to go over here where there's a field with 3 pieces of wood. So they'll put one worker down there, and then maybe because they have to go over here into the colony area, remember their king's request is to get ships into the colonies, you're going to need wine to sell in order to do that, and therefore they're going to put their other worker down here in this grape field, this wine field. Okay. That ends the setup for the game. Now we're into the playing the game. now we're in round one, phase A, which is called round setup. Before we were doing game setup, now we're doing round setup. And you'll see there's a little reminder down here that I placed that says one crown's request, or king's request, no matter, regardless of how you refer to it, is going to be due by the end of this round. So by the end of round one, each player is going to have to score for one king's request and then discard it. Now, remember I said earlier that by the time the end of round one comes around, every player is going to have two king's requests to choose from. So now we're working in turn order. Before we were setting up in reverse turn order. Now we're playing in turn order. And as part of the new round setup, each player has to choose a set of dice to work with, a set of guild dice. So you'll see that in a two-player game, there are two sets of guild dice to choose from, and they're teal in color. There's also a set of dice over here called the pirate dice. They're black in the northern. I'm just storing them up here in the City Watch, but in fact, all these dice are usually just placed off to the side or on this guild board, this turn order board, if you will, that I'm showing here on the right side of the screen. So there are four things to consider when you are choosing a set of dice. One is obviously, what's the value of the dice? Now these are six-sided dice, and two of the faces have a one, two of the faces have a two, two of the faces have a three. So in this case, we only rolled 1 3, and that was a pirate die over here. But the guild dice turned out to be 2 2 and 1 and 1 2 and 1. So in fact, they're pretty close in value. One of the things to consider, as I said, is what are the value of the guild dice that you're choosing. The second thing to consider is where are they on the turn order board? Because if you choose this set of guild dice, you're going to be in first starting player position. And if you choose this set of guild dice, you're going to be in the second turn order position. And there's a turn order board for a three-player game and for a four-player game, obviously, that have different spots for different turn order positions. So do you want a high set of dice? Do you want to be in first place or second place? Do you want to have a set of dice that represents one guild or another? As you collect guild favors over the course of the game and you use their special abilities, you will tap those guild favors. They'll get flipped face down. One way to flip them face up so they can be used again and be scored, for example, if you happen to have the guild favor that allows you to, the king's request, the crown's request that allows you to score for guild favors, those have to be face up as well. So you could see that if I pick this set of dice, I could then either choose to flip over my white or my green guild favors face up. Not both, but either white or green. If I chose this set of dice, I could flip over my red or my purple guild favors. Now, at the beginning of the game, obviously, nobody has any guild favors, so this particular criterion doesn't come into play. But it is something to consider later in the game. The last criteria that you consider is what king's requests are you going to be able to choose from? Because once you choose a set of dice, you're then going to have to choose that second king's request, at least in round one that I refer to, either from this set that goes with the first set of dice or from this set which go with the second set of dice. Now, in a two-player game, remember that there are a total of five different king's requests, and in a two-player game, there are two of each of the king's requests that are that make up this board, not counting the starting king's request. So you can see that there are two of these Wealth of the Nations king's requests. These are the city king's requests, where you try to get a majority or presence in the city. You can see there are two expeditions king's requests. There are two market route king's requests, and finally there are two guild favor king's requests. And these are all randomly placed. And so you can see that if you wanted to get a guild favor King's Request, which happens to earn the most points. You could potentially earn 20 points with the one of these Guild Favor King's Requests. If you wanted to get one, you have to choose the top set of dice in this particular game, because both of the King's Requests end up in the top group. If you wanted to get a City King's Request, you will want to be in the bottom group here. Now, let me mention that, I've seen players get stuck playing this game sometimes. When you happen to have two King's Requests at some point during the game that are the same, and if you want to surrender them at the same time, you have to surrender them and score them using different resources, different parts of whatever it is that you're trying to score. For example, let's say you happen to have an Expeditions King's Request that scores for having ships in colonies. Let's say you have two of those. You can't score three ships for each one of those King's Requests. You have to score different ships for the different King's Requests. So if you only have three ships, you're really only going to be able to score one of the Expeditions King's Requests in your possession. You really would want to have... So you want to try to have, in this game, different King's Requests to score at the end of any particular round. Now, the reason I started this little diatribe is because this one, the one that can score you up to 20 points for having multiple guild favors, that one's a little hard to score because you have to have different guild favors of different guilds. And getting guilds in this game, particularly in a two-player game, is not especially easy. Maybe you can get one or two in a round. So you're not going to be able to score one of these for a large number of points, say, at the end of round one. But say by the end of the game, you should be able to pull off scoring one of these King's Requests for having four different guild favors representing four different guilds. The problem is you don't want to get stuck with two of them, because let's say it's the end of the game and you have two of those King's Requests. You can score maybe one of them using two of your guild favors and one of them using the other two, but you're still going to end up with a maximum of 20 points. And in that case, you're scoring 20 points for having two King's Requests. So that's an average of 10 per King's Request. Not great. The average for these King's Requests, or the minimum you want to aim for, is 15 points. You can see here, the best you can do for having a City King's Request is 15 points. The best you can do for getting three ships in the market route area is 6 plus 6 plus 6 points by having, let's say, one ship. Well, in round one, you could have a... You score 6 points for having these ships in the sugar area. So if you had three ships in the sugar area at the end of round one, you could score as much as 18 points. In the in this area, the same thing goes, although it's currently covered up. The colonies, you could score a maximum of 18 points as well for that guild favor. And as we already saw, for the money guild favor, you could score a maximum of 15. So, my point being, you don't want to get stuck with two of these guild favor King's Requests. And as you can see, both of them happen to end up in the top section of the guild requests. Anyway, I talked too long. Let's get the game underway. So what's Red going to do? Well, pretty obvious choice. Let's pick this first set of dice. It's a little bit better than this set of dice. It puts Red player in turn order one, turn position one. They're going to be the starting player. That's a nice place to be. And they'll have first dibs on this one of these King's Requests. So they're going to choose this set of dice. It's going to go down into their player area over here. So they have a 2, 2, and a 1. And now they have to choose from one of these five King's Requests to add to the one that they already have, which is this Expeditions King's Request. So they're not going to take another Expeditions King's Request. I think what they're going to do is, while it would be nice to go for this Guild Favor one, because it can potentially earn 20 points. It's not one that's going to easily get fulfilled by the end of round one. It can get scored later on in the game. So for that reason, I'm going to go with the market route King's Request, because that's also scored using ships. And you could potentially use the ships. You could get the ships that are, say in the colony area and sail them down to the market route area at some other time during the game and then score points for the same ships. So I'm going to have my second King's Request be this market route King's Request. So that gives me one of each of those. And now the blue player gets second turn order, gets that other set of dice, 1, 2, and 1. And now they have to choose from one of these King's Requests. And they would have liked to have gotten a market King's Request, because remember, they're building, they went into the wood city and they're trying to get wood to build ships to go down here to score, to get, earn money and then hopefully earn points. But unfortunately, they didn't get one of those. They only have to fulfill one King's Request by the end of round one. So I think they're going to go for maybe one of the easiest ones to fill, and that is the one that earns points for dollars. They already have one of those, but at least at the end of round one, they only have to fulfill one of them, and then by that point, they'll only have one remaining, and they can plan on making sure they get a different King's Request by the time round three comes around. So I'm going to grab another one of these. And now the game is underway. Now we start with the red player. They're in the first turn position. They have to take a die, one of their die, or one of the pirate dice, and place them in a particular building on a particular character. Now we're going to talk about characters, because as part of setup, the five different characters in the game have been shuffled randomly and randomly placed in these different cities. Now, in fact, in the base game, there are four character tiles. This guy, who is the steward, this fellow over here is the mayor, this one's the commander, and this one is the guild master, if I'm hopefully not mixing them up. So, in fact, in the base game, you take these four character tiles, you shuffle them up randomly, and you place them in these four different cities. The fifth city is also always reserved as a round counter. So whatever city in the base game is empty is round one. So is the current round. So in round one, you always keep this city empty. In round two, you would keep this city empty and put the four characters in the other four cities. And then round three, round four, and round five. So that empty city sort of migrates from one city to the next as a round counter. This micro expansion that I was referring to is the fifth character tile called the Harvester. And so I am playing with this little extra tile. And as I said, the image is easily available. You could mock it up yourself, put it on a piece of cardboard. And the Harvester in this case is going to bounce around from the first city in the round one into the second city in round two, the third city in round three, and so forth. So the Harvester is going to move in a particular order over the course of the game. But the other four are randomly assigned to the other four buildings, as each round progresses. So at the beginning of every round, these four characters are just randomly assigned. Each of these characters provides a particular benefit or a particular action. So when I take one of my dice, say, and place it on a character, I have a choice of either taking the character's action or taking what's called a standard harvesting action, which allows me to earn a resource for each one of my workers in the fields. So, for example, let's say I placed a die on the commissioner here. He's in Region 3. I would have to actually place a die that was equal to or greater in value than 3. Well, that's basically the highest value of dice. If you don't put a 3 die on the commissioner, or for that matter on the harvester, both of which are associated with Region 3, you have to pay bread to make up the difference. And remember, I said bread, one of the second reasons for having bread is for performing these actions. When you don't have an action die that's sufficient to have enough influence, if you will, to get the ability out of these particular characters. So to put it in thematic terms, the commander here requires that somebody come to see him who has a lot of influence, a guild die or a pirate die that has a 3 on it. If you don't have sufficient influence, he's going to demand that you pay him bread to make up the difference. So if I was going to take one of my 2 dice and put them on the commission of the commander, I would have to also pay 1 bread to make up the difference between 3 and 2, because he just happened to go in region 3. If I, on the other hand, took one of my 2 dice and placed them on the guildmaster, who's in region 1, I'm simply overpaying. I'm walking in the door and he says, "Ooh, I didn't expect to see you today. You have a lot of influence, and I don't really require that much. Please have a seat. Let me see how I can help you." So, remember I said when you place a die on a character, you can either take the character's action or you can take the standard harvesting action. So the standard harvesting action for, let's say, the commander, because he's in region 3, I would earn, in this case, because I'm red, so I'm over here, I would earn 1 wood from this field over here, depleting my wood pieces by 2, to 2 rather. And so that's not much of a harvest, getting 1 piece of wood. That's not terrific, but that's why most of the time you're going to be putting a die on a building in order to take the character's action. Now, what are the character's actions? Well, I'm going to make things easier and turn on something that shows you what the various actions are. So it just makes the board a little bit busier, but it's certainly going to help you, because you're new to the game, to know what you can do with these various characters. So you can see that the commander, no matter in which building he happens to be, his action is, and it's in this gray box, move or launch 2 ships to sell goods. The guildmaster's character action is buy guild favors with wood, or actually buy a guild favor with wood. Actually, that should probably say buy 1. The mayor's action is relocate 2 city workers and then earn favors or resources, rather, or goods. It says goods, it probably just as well say resources. The steward down here, his action is move 2 workers to the fields. Now, normally, if you're just playing with the base game, you've got, remember I said you have 1 building that's empty, that doesn't have a character tile on it. And if you put your worker there, the action of the empty building, the empty character action, is to also perform a harvest, but to get 1 extra harvest of 1 of your fields. So in this, let's say I was in this wood field, and let's say I also had a worker in the sugar field. If I was doing that extra special harvest, I would get 1 wheat, 1 wood, and then I could get an extra wood or an extra wheat in that case. Here we're playing with the harvester tile. The harvester tile is a little bit better than that. It allows you to place a die in 1 of 4 sections of the tile. If you put a die up here, you do a normal harvest, but then as long as you have a worker in a wheat field, you get an extra 2 wheat. If you put a die over here, you can get an extra 2 sugar if you have a worker in a sugar field. If you have a worker in a wine field, you can get an extra 2 wine or grapes. And if you put the die here, this one's sort of like the default behavior if you're not playing with the harvester tile. That is, choose 1 of the fields in which you have a worker, and you can earn 1 extra resource of that type, 1 extra good. So this, as you can see, this one's a little bit better. So if I use the harvester tile as the red player, and let's say I put my die here in the plus 2 wand, well, actually, in this particular instance, if I put it in any of these 3 areas, I'm not going to get any benefit, because red doesn't have anything except for a wood field. But let's say we were playing with blue. Blue's in a sugar field, so if I put a die into the plus 2 sugar area, a blue would be able to harvest 3 sugars using that benefit of the tile. Obviously, once you put a die in one of these 4 areas, it's off limits to the other players until the next round. Now, So that's the harvester action. So we've talked about the character actions for each one of these characters. You'll also notice that there's this other action down below, which is called the building action. Now, we're currently in Phase B, the character action phase of the game. But when Phase C comes around, we'll be able to take building actions as well, as long as two things are true. One, we have one of our action markers in the building, meaning we won't be able to take a building action unless we have placed one of our guild dice in that building during Phase B to take the corresponding character action. So, as an example, again, if I placed one of my guild dice here with the commander, I could move or launch two ships, and then potentially in Phase C, I would then be able to perform the building action, which is flip one or two of my guild favors face up, if I happen to have any. But you have to fulfill one other requirement to get the building action in Phase C, and I'm simply telling you this so that you can kind of keep this in mind. Looking forward, you not only have to have placed a guild dice in the building during Phase B, but you also will have to pay a price. We don't know what that price is, but the more guild dice that get placed in the building, the lower the price will be. And you don't have, so you have some control over that, but it also depends upon, you know, what other players place guild dice in that building. Also, if there's a pirate die in a building, that increases the cost in pirates of not performing the building action. So when Phase C comes around, we're going to either have to pay X amount of dollars in order to perform the building action, or maybe not perform the building action. Maybe we don't. Maybe we don't have one or two guild favors to turn face up. So we could, while we're in there, we may have to still pay the cost of the bill of using the building, of visiting it. Excuse me. But actually we're going to be paying for nothing, for not being able to use the building action. If you choose not to pay the money to take the building action, then you have to take pirates. And you have to take pirates equal to the value of the pirate die in the building plus one. So if there was a pirate die that got re-rolled, because these dice get re-rolled in Phase C, if it was three pirates, then you would have to pay four pirates if you decided not to pay the dollar amount. So there's this pay or not pay little choice you have to make, which can be a difficult choice depending upon how the dice turn out. And that is totally random. As I said, you do have a little control over it, because the more guild dice in the building, the lower the price is going to be for using the building action, or at least for avoiding having to take pirates. So that's one way to avoid getting pirates. But we'll talk more about that when we get into Phase C. I wanted to also mention that each building has a maximum number of dice. You can't have any more dice in a building than the number of players. So in this two-player game, two dice is the maximum in a building. And the maximum number of pirate dice in a building is one. You can't have more than one pirate die in a building. So a building is going to be full when it has two guild dice in it, or one guild die and one pirate die. But once there's a pirate die in a building, you can't put another one in that same building. Now, all that talk aside, Red has to make the decision. Do they want to place one of their guild dice? Do they want to place one of the pirate dice? Playing one of the pirate dice, obviously, is a way to get an extra action. Because if you don't use pirate dice, you only get three character actions with your guild dice. But if you do use a pirate die, for every one you use, you get an extra action. So, but there's a cost to using a pirate die, as we'll soon find out. Well, let's talk about what Red wants to do here. So we know that Red wants to build ships, because they need to get these ships into the either the market route area or the expedition, the colony area, depending upon which one of these they plan to fulfill at the end of round one. In order to get ships out, they're going to need wood. Right now, Red only has one wood to his name. So one way to get wood is down here in the Wood City. No surprise there. Another way to get wood is to harvest wood in any particular field where you happen to have wood. So one way to get, so I'm faced with a choice here. Do I want to, let's say, get more workers into my fields where I happen to have wood so I can harvest more wood when I do a harvest? Or do I want to try to make sure I get the maximum number of workers in the wood city so that when I score the wood city for wood, I get the maximum amount of wood? I think in this particular case, I can get more wood out of the wood city than I can get out of the fields, out of the harvesting. And that's because when you score a wood city, when you actually perform the character action that allows you to score cities, and I say score, I'm not saying score by meaning scoring points, but rather by earning either wood, money, or bread. When you do that, you basically look through each one of the cities, and wherever you have one of your own workers, you can earn, be it bread, money, or wood, 2 units for each one of your workers and 1 unit for each neutral worker. So if I can get another neutral worker, say, from the bread city or the money city, move down to this empty field, into this empty city spot, then I could potentially earn 4 wood. 2 wood for my player worker and 1 for each of the neutral workers. That's more wood than I could possibly get right now by harvesting. So I think I'm going to go that route. Now, in order to perform that action, in order to earn that wood, to get it added to my supply, I need to go to the mayor, who allows me to relocate 2 city workers for goods. Now, I can't relocate my opponent's workers. I can only relocate my workers and the neutral citizens or the neutral workers. Now, you can see that that character is in the building in Region 2, which happens to be perfect because I happen to have 2 dice that have a 2 on them, and it's not going to cost me any extra bread. I did say that there is a cost to using one of these pirate dice, and that cost is that you have to give up one of your workers in the city watch. They have to go back, it has to go back to your supply. So if I want to use one of these dice, one of these workers is going to leave the city watch, go back to my supply, and there are points to be earned at the end of the round for having the majority in the city watch. There is a way to get more workers into the city watch if I happen to take some out. But suffice it to say that if one of my workers leaves the city watch, I'm giving blue the edge at being able to score those 4 points at the end of the round for having the majority. So for the time being, I think I'm going to use one of my guild dice and place that. Well, no, wait a second. Before I do that, because there's only one... there's only 1 3 on the board, remember, and that happens to be a pirate die. So if I want to avoid paying bread, somebody's going to have to use that 3 if they want to either use the commander or the harvesting function. This is a little bit tricky. Using the 3 for a harvest right now is not going to help me as the red player because I only have workers in a wood field, in a location where there's wood. I could perhaps go in this spot and allow myself, I could pick up 2 wood that way. If I put the 3 over here in the commander area, I can move or launch 2 ships to sell goods. I do have some goods and I do have 1 wood. Now, when you run out of wood, you can buy additional wood from areas of the board where you have access to wood. That's the way wood works in this game. You just can't buy wood. You have to get wood. You have to pay workers, other workers who happen to be in your fields where you have access to wood to chop down some trees to get you the wood. The more wood you buy in any particular turn, the more you have to pay, and that's what this table is used for. So if you want to buy 1 wood, you're going to have to pay $1. If you want to buy 2 wood, you're going to have to pay 3. If you want to buy 3, you have to pay 6. So it grows grows in number. I think that because there's only one 3 die on the board, I think I'm going to grab it before the blue player does and use it and place it on the commissioner here. And use his character action right away, even though it's going to cost me to, say, launch a second ship. And I am still going to have to find a source of wood because I have to, remember, pay for the upkeep of those ships later on during the game. Now, that's going to cost me one of my workers in the City Watch. So as soon as I do this, the worker leaves the City Watch, goes back to my supply. So now I have 8 workers in my supply, and Blue now has the majority in the City Watch. But I have successfully placed this pirate die here, and now I can take the move or the commander's action, which is move or launch 2 ships to sell goods. It costs a wood to launch each ship. We don't have to launch 2. We could just launch 1, but as long as we're launching, I think I'm going to launch 2, which means I'm going to have to pay for one of the ships with one of my wood, and then I'm going to have to buy a piece of wood from my only source of wood, which happens to be up here in the northwest corner of Madeira. Let's first get our first ship launched. Now, remember, I think I'm going to go for the market route, because there I could sell either sugar, wheat, or wine, and I happen to start the game with one of each, so it's a little bit more flexible. So I'm going to take one of my ships from red, and let's see, what's going to earn me the most money right now? I can get $3 for wheat, $5 for 1 sugar, $4 for 1 wine. So I'm going to sell, I'm going to launch a ship and put it down here so I can sell 1 sugar for $5. Now, it cost me a wood. As you can see, my wood now is gone. And now I'm going to take a second ship and sell the 1 wine that I have for $4. So I'm going to come down here. Okay, so now I'm down to only 1 wheat to my name, but I've successfully launched 2 ships, made a good amount of money there, $10. And I do have to pay for that 1 wood that I just used to launch the ship. The only source of wood I have is this wood field over here, so that's where I'm going to get the wood to pay. And ring-a-ding, there's a cost. And remember, the cost of 1 wood in any turn is just $1, so that's not so bad. So I'm going to end my turn paying that dollar, and now I'm going to be at $15. So that's not a bad profit for 1 turn. Okay, so now it is the blue player's turn finally, and there are now no 3 dice on the board, so that makes things a little simpler. He wants to get wood, and the best source of wood is to relocate 2 city workers for goods. So I'm going to take my 2 die, the only 2 die I have, go into region 2, so it doesn't cost me extra bread, and I'm going to visit the mayor. I'm going to say, Mr. Mayor, would you please help me here? I need some wood. So he's going to say, okay, go into the wood city, and you can move some workers around. Now I can't move the blue worker. I'm sorry, I can't move the red worker. That's my opponent. But I can move my workers and the neutral workers. Now my worker already is in the wood city, and there is already 1 neutral worker in the wood city. And there's only 1 more empty city spot, so I'm going to take this guy and move him down here. Now I've got 2 neutral workers and 1 of my player workers. That's going to earn me 4 wood when I now end the turn. Because when the mayor's action is relocate up to 2 different workers in the city area. You can't bring in new workers. You have to only relocate the ones that are already there. And then you can, once you do that, you go through each city, and wherever you have a worker, you score 2 bread, 2 money, or 2 wood for your player workers, and 1 for each neutral citizen. So I'm going to get 4 wood. So I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And now it says you can take 4 wood free of charge from your wood fields. Again, wood just doesn't come from anywhere in this game. You have to get it from your source of wood. So my only source of wood as the blue player is this field over here, and lo and behold, it's got 4 pieces of wood in it. So I got to take all of it. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I just got my 4 pieces of wood. And now the wood's all gone from this field, so it's now become a sugar field. It very quickly got plowed over, and now it's growing sugar. So I have a source of sugar all of a sudden. But I don't no longer have a source of wood, so I'm going to have to do something about that, probably in my next turn. Anyway, let's go back to red. Okay, so red used a pirate die last turn. They launched some ships. They too want to have a nice source of wood. So before this mayor's area is filled up, remember, 2 dice and that's it, they're going to put a guild die in there. Now, they could grab this other pirate die and just say, okay, the heck with it. Maybe I'm giving these 2 points away, but at least I'm going to have a lot of extra actions. And I know I'm red. I'm not going to have an action marker in the city, so I'm not going to have to pay the cost of using the city. But potentially blue may have to pay a large number of pirates to not use the city because they do have an action marker there. I need to have a better source of wood. In order to do that, I need to go and visit the steward over here and ask him to allow me to get some workers in fields. That allows me to move 2 workers from anywhere on the board except from the city watch, I can move them from my supply, which is probably what I'm going to do, and move them into new fields so I can get a source of something other than what I already have a source of. So that's going to cost me a 2 die. In this case, then, I think I'm going to, I may get burned by the blue player by doing this, but I could bring the pirate die down here and then not plan to move any more workers. Yeah, I think maybe that's what I'll do. Let's see what the building action is. Score 1 to 3 points and move 1 to 2 workers to the cities. But that would be nice not to give that action up, potentially. And I should point out that when you perform the building action in phase C, you'll notice that each one of these building actions is to do this or that. Gain 2 or 5 bread, score 1 or 3 points, and move 1 or 2 workers to the cities. You can get the lesser of the 2 actions if you have 1 or 2 workers in that particular region of the city, of the board. So in this particular case, if I wanted to get the minimum building action from this building later on in phase C, I would have to have at least 1 or 2 of my workers in this region. And I do currently. I have this guy in the grate. If I wanted to get the better version of the building action, score 3 points and move 2 workers to the cities, I would need to have 3 or more workers in the southern coast of the main island. So, question is, do I want to put a pirate die here, or do I want to put one of my own dice here? Chances are, blue's going to go there as well, because blue's going to want to do the same thing. He's going to need a source of wood going forward. So I think I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to put the pirate die down here, figuring I'm not going to get another chance to come back in here. And now, by doing that, I have no workers left in the city watch, so I am pretty much guaranteeing that blue's going to get that 4 points. But I can now take the action, and I'm pretty much giving up the opportunity to use this building action. Which maybe isn't such a great idea. Because like I said, the only way to get more, well, there are other ways to get guys moved into the city. There's a King's Favor over here that allows you to get a guy moved into a city. There is, you can pass later in the game and get a guy into the city. So I'm not completely giving up that ability. Okay, I think I guess I'm going to give up the pirate die. Although, well, I have to make a decision here. So let's go ahead and use the pirate die. I'm just going to give up. I'll plan on getting my points and my guys into the city some other way. So I'm going to use the pirate die. I can now move two workers to any field in which that I don't currently occupy. So I'm going to go to my supply. And remember, for every one of my workers on the board, I'm going to have to pay a bread. Currently, let me talk briefly about that. Currently, I have to pay three bread because I have three workers on the board. I've got one down in this field, one in the city, and one in this field over here. At the end of the round, you've got to pay bread for the workers, one bread per worker. However, you can get the minimum number of bread you need by going over to the windmill, because whatever position you happen to start out in, that you happen to be in the windmill, will pay a certain amount of bread to feed your workers. And because all players start at the third position of the windmill, you can immediately and automatically pay off three bread to feed workers. So as long as I only have three workers, I'm not out of any bread as long as I stay on the third step of the windmill. Now, if I bring out a fourth worker, I'm going to have to pay a bread at the end of the round or get myself moved up on the windmill. So I might as well talk about the windmill real briefly. The windmill allows me, the windmill is basically a source of money or bread. And during phases B, C, or D, I can move up a step on the windmill by paying 2 wheat. Okay, so it costs me 2 wheat, move up a step, and now all of a sudden I'm paying 4 bread for 4 workers at the end of the round for free. Well, not for free, but it costs me some wheat, but you get the drift. So in phases B, C, or D, I can move up on the windmill at a cost of 2 wheat, 1 step, and have a source of more bread. During phases B and C, but not during phase D, which is the maintenance phase, I can move down 1 step on the windmill and earn either 1 bread or $3. So it's a quick source of money or bread, being on the windmill. Now, if I go all the way to the bottom of the windmill and I try to go down a step again, then I really only have a choice of 1 bread and $1, and I have to give up a point to do that. So the cost at the bottom of the windmill is pay a point to get a buck or a bread. As long as you're anywhere else in the windmill, you basically go down 1 step and you get a choice of $3 or 1 bread, but you don't have to give up a point. And if you get to the top of the windmill, the seventh step, and you want to go higher, you can always pay 2 wheat to get a point. Well, I suppose if you have a large supply of wheat, that's not a bad exchange. I don't foresee being able to get that high on the windmill. But anyway, I covered my point and I talked about the windmill. And now where was I? Oh, yeah. So anyway, I was moving 2 workers to the fields. Okay. So I'm going to take one of my workers from the supply. This is going to be my fourth worker now that's going out on the board. And I'm going to get him and place him in the King's Forest so that I have a source of wood going forward in the game, even if my wood dries up. Well, my wood has already dried up here in this field. Where are we? No, it hasn't. I have 2 pieces of wood remaining, but once I used up all that wood, my only other source now is going to be this King's Forest. So once you get in there, and it's pretty much guaranteed that at some point during the game, you are probably going to have to get a worker into the King's Forest so that you can guarantee that you have a source of wood going forward. Now, I can move another worker if I want into a field, and I think I am going to put a worker in this sugarcane field Now, do I want to be on the north side or the south side? Yeah, I guess if I'm going to use the harvester at some point, I want to be on the north side because that's the region he covers. So let me drop him there. Okay, so those are my two workers. My turn's over. I go back to blue. All right, so blue, you only have a choice of ones, which is not great. You do have four bread, but thinking ahead, you got to pay bread to feed those five workers that you have on the board currently. At least three of that bread is going to come from the windmills. But not having enough bread in phase D means basically that you're going to have to pay pirates. So I need a source of bread. And the only way to get bread, really, is from the cities. Let's see here. I've already gotten my wood. I could move my workers to the bread city. Maybe, and then get a load of bread. Now, I still haven't achieved my main objective, which was getting some guys out into the... Let's see, I'm trying to sell some stuff. And right now, the sell one good spots have been taken up by Red. And I can't bump him out. So I can right now I can only sell one wheat. So I think maybe I need to harvest real quickly. Let me think about this. Maybe if I go into the, I could go to the harvester. I currently have a guy here in this sugarcane field. If I go to the harvester into the plus two sugar spot, I can earn three sugar and real quickly earn 11 bucks that way. And then maybe I could sell one wheat at the same time if Red doesn't get there first. And within one turn, potentially with the commander, make 14 bucks. Yes, the red player could steal the commander away from me by putting another die in there, but I don't know that he's going to do that because there's a pirate die in there already, so it's potentially going to cost him pirates later on. I'm going to gamble. I'm going to go ahead and do that. So the problem is that the harvester's in region 3. I only have a 1 die, and it's going to cost me 2 bread. So am I cutting off my nose to spite my face? Let's think about this. If I put a worker over there and I'm paying 2 bread to eventually be able to get more sugar. No, I think I'm all right. I think I'm all right. And hopefully I can make use of the mayor later, if he's still available, to get the bread I need in order to pay for the food to feed the workers. So I think I will put one of my guild dice up here in the harvester in the plus two sugar area. That's going to cost me 2 bread, so my bread supply has gone down to 4, but I am now... Oh, actually, I have 4 sugar. I'm sorry. I started off with 1 sugar, so I'm going to be able to potentially sell 4 sugar and 1 wheat for a total of $17. So, hopefully I'll be able to have an opportunity to ship. And even if Red does steal away the commander and put another die there, there are other ways to ship. For example, there's this, I can pass later and ship, and we'll talk about passing when the time comes. So I think I'm okay for the time being. And I've got 2 bread now and 5 wood. Got 1 guild die left, there's 1 pirate die left. So we are quickly running out of actions, that's for sure. Okay, Red, on the other hand, who has only used pirate die so far, has lots of actions remaining. So what do they want to do now? So they've got 4 bread, 1 wheat. So they could use some goods if they want to do some more selling. And in order to do that, they would have to do a harvest. And Red is already up here in a sugar field. Unfortunately, Blue has taken the plus 2 sugar. So the best that Red could do right now, well, He's got lots of dice, so maybe he grabs this spot first to get workers workers in the fields. If he goes here, he was the one that put the pirate die here to begin with, right? He could potentially be burning himself. If he plans on paying the, if I put a die in here, by the time the building action phase comes around, what happens in the building action phase? Remember, I said all these dice get re-rolled. Well, the price of using the building in phase C, after you've re-rolled the dice, is in a two-player game, 8 minus the value of the guild dice that you re-rolled in that building. So if I put one of my guild dice in here, the best I can hope for is to pay $5, meaning I roll a 3, and then I pay 8 minus 3, or $5, to make use of this building. If I don't pay the $5, and remember, well, I don't need a lot of money, because I don't have a king's request that requires money right now. I just have to have, and I've already fulfilled much of my king's request by having my two of my ships down here. So the other negative is that if I don't pay the $5 or the 6 or the 7, whatever it turns out to be, then I have to pay a number of pirates equal to whatever the reroll value is on the pirate die plus 1. And if there doesn't happen to be a pirate die in a city and you have to determine pirates, then you just, in that case, simply pay 1 pirate because there's no pirate die, so plus 1, 0 plus 1 is 1. So I think I'm going to go ahead and do that. And I do have a worker in the region too, so I could potentially make use of at least the lesser part of this building action when building action's phase comes around. So I'm going to take one of my two dice and drop it in here. Now I could also use the other pirate die and give up that action altogether and just pay a bread. Oh, I can't. I'm out of workers in the city watch. I've used up all the pirate dice I can. So here we go. I'm dropping my two die here into region two, into this building. Doesn't cost me any additional bread. Now I can move two workers to the fields. Okay, now I'm a little confused. What did red do last turn? Red did the same thing. Oh, right. Okay. Yes, that's right. So I was talking about possibly making better use of a harvester because I can't go into the plus 2 sugar spot, and that's the only field I currently occupy. So now I'm basically doing the same action. I'm just doing it again. So now I'm moving two more workers into the fields. Now, if I wanted to get the better benefit of the building action, I would have to move both my workers down here into region two, but then I won't get the benefit of the harvester who was in region one, region three. This is tricky to say the least. I think I will, what workers do I want to move? And how's my bread supply doing? I've got plenty of bread for the time being. Let me take a worker from the supply and I can't get extra sugar, so I can't sell lots of sugar. Red's already taken that ability. I'm sorry, blue's already taken that ability, so do I go to wheat and plan on selling a lot of wheat? I guess that's what I do, because there's no grape field in region 3. That's not so bad. Okay, so let me put a worker in the wheat field here. Let me take another worker and put him. Do I want to go back? Do I want to stay in region 3, or do I, because the notice, and I think it's obvious by now, this character ability, move two workers to the fields. You can move them to any fields. You don't have to just move them to the field that the region the character happens to be in. And sorry, I think this video program that records video leaves lots of artifacts on the board, but that'll get cleared up on the momentarily. So do I want to go into a wood city here, or do I want to drop into the southern region? Now, I don't get the benefit until I have three workers down there. So I think I'm going to go here. What was this? Before I do that, I'll just drop him out of the way. What was this? This was a great field. This is another wheat field, potentially. Okay, so let me grab a worker and drop him. Let me go into the grape field up here. Oh, I can't. I'm already there. So let me go into this other wheat field here. But I also have another source of wood. Okay. So I moved two workers to the fields. Now I'm set up well in order to perform a harvesting action later. So I'll end my turn, turn it back over to Blue, who is pretty much on his last turn at this point. He could use a pirate die, so we could get two more actions, and maybe he should, considering the fact that Red's gotten two extra actions this round, and he could still retain the majority in the city watch. Blue has lots of wood currently. He hasn't gotten any ships on the board yet. Actually, that's really his overriding objective right now, isn't it? Because he has to make money, and he only has $8 to his name. And he got all that sugar last turn to do that. So I guess that's what we're going to do. So it is going to cost us all the bread we have. That was the other thing we wanted to do, wasn't it? We wanted to get into the bread city in order to get more bread. Let's do first things first. Let's get got two bread and five wood. I always can. I think let's get some bread. Maybe I'll do that first. And maybe I'll do it with a pirate die. It's going to cost me a bread. It's going to cost me one bread, but I'll be able to get two red. I'll be able to get four red back, so I'm going to get a net plus of three bread. So I'm going to use a pirate die. I'm potentially burning myself because I have one guy down here, but I will be able to potentially use this building action later. It might cost me a lot of money, and I do need money. I'm going to go down here. I'm going to use a pirate die, give up a worker in the city watch, pay a bread. But now I'm going to move workers around to get the most bread that I possibly can. So I'm going to obviously have to move my player worker up there. So I'm going to move him up. And then I'm going to take this guy and move him up here. And now I've relocated my two workers in the cities, and that's going to get me four bread when I score it. So now I'm up to five bread. So five bread, five wood. Going into my last turn is not so bad. So now it's Red again. He's got two dice, and so easy to forget. Okay, yeah, he wanted to do a harvest. So this one's going to cost him a bread again. He's going to take his two die and pop up here into the harvest, and he is going to go into the wheat area because he'll have an opportunity. Because he's in a wheat field, he'll be able to harvest an extra two wheat. So this is going to give him a wood, a wheat, a sugar, and two more wheat. A big harvest. So I go here, I harvest here, I harvest here, I harvest here, and now I get a plus two harvest here. So that just scored me a lot of goods. Not bad at all. Okay, back to Blue. Blue finally has to ship, and it's going to cost him some of that precious bread. But he doesn't really have much of a choice, so he's going to take his one die, come up here to the commander. It's going to cost him two bread, because the commander wants more influence than what that one die offers. So we've just paid two bread, as you can see. And now he can launch two ships to sell goods. Well, what does he have to sell? He's got four sugar, and one wheat or one wine. Well, he can't go into the one wine spot, but he can go into the one wheat spot. So he's going to take one of his ships and launch it into this one wheat spot, which is going to cost him a wood, but get him $3. So I think I just missed. Let's try that again. There we go. Okay, $3. But even better than that is to take another ship, and let's not mess this up. I want to go into the four sugar spot. Now, this spot is only used in a 3 or 4 player game. However, I can go up here in a 2-player game, and I get a choice of either surrendering 3 goods or 4 goods. Now, my program automatically notices that I do have 4 goods of sugar, so it says, do you want to unload all 4 sugar? And I can always click no and decide to go with 3 sugar instead. But I'm going to go sell all my sugar for $14. And now I've got a lot of, I'm up to $25. And remember, I have a king's request that gets me points for up to $15. So I've got plenty of money to get the points and also money left over to pay for building actions in phase C. Okay, that ends my turn. We're back to player one. Player one, remember, he wants to score this market route. And he wants to have up to 3 ships in the markets. He only has 2 down there right now. So he needs to find another way to get ships into the markets. Is this the guy I'm thinking of? No, there is a guild favor that allows you to do that, but it's not this one. Yeah. The one I'm thinking of is the Navigator. I think he's called the Navigator, which allows you to perform a shipping action. But I think he didn't get included in this particular game. He happened to get randomized out. So, but that's a different point altogether. So I would like to perform another shipping action, but I can't because now that space is taken over. So my only other option of being able to get a shipping action is to be able to go down here and be able and pass in the fourth passing area, and that gets me another shipping. I'd be able to do 1 ship, which is okay. Well, that's plenty. And I have 4 wheat to sell, so that spot's open. So I'm okay. So the question is, what do I want to do with my last die? Now, blue's going to pass first. Remember, blue doesn't have any dice left, and there's no pirate dice left. So blue's going to pass on their next turn. And they could try to burn me by passing and grabbing this 4 spot, knowing that I'm not going to be able to get to. They'd be giving up the possibility of being in first turn order for selecting dice next round, but they would burn me out of getting another ship. So maybe I give up my 1 die. Well, blue might not do that. Blue may decide that they want first dibs on the dice. Because he didn't get first dibs on the dice, I think, in this round. So maybe I'll gamble. Where can I put this 1 die that'll do me so good? Well, the harvester's filled up. Everybody's filled up except for this guy, which is by a guild favor. So the question is there a guild favor here that even interests me? The Purple Guild, the High Commissioner. Oh, sorry, a really, really bad image. I should rescan that. Gain $4 and you immediately move 1 of your workers to any colony except from the City Watch. Then score 1 point for each of your ships in that colony. And you may perform the action of 1 of the 2 King's Rewards in that colony. And is there a King of Reward? No, there's not a King's Reward that allows me to ship. There's one that allows me to move into a city, and the City Watch, and the fields, and move a step up on the windmill. I guess I should talk about these various King's Rewards. Move a guy into a field, move a step up on the windmill for free, move a guy into the city, and that's move a guy into the city, not relocate a guy into the city. Score 3 points, move a guy into the City Watch, and earn $5. So anyway, so I'm talking about guild favors. So gain $4, move a guy into the colonies, move a ship into the colonies. No, move a worker into the colonies. And I don't have any ships there, so I'm not going to score any points for having a worker there. Although I can get goods. One of the things you do in the maintenance phase is that if you have any workers in the colony lands up here, a guy over here can, each worker over here can gain get you wheat. Each guy over here can get you sugar. Each guy over here can get you wine. So that's not terrible, but it's not great either. The constable here, discard half of your pirates rounded down. Well, I don't currently have any, but I will have some soon, I bet. And then the monk here, gain 2 wood from a field in which you have a worker, or from the supply, but only if you have a worker in the forest. So basically gain 2 wood. That's not bad, because I'm going to need wood to pay for my ships anyway, and I haven't gotten that extra city action that I was hoping. Well, I can't do it now anyway, because the mayor's all filled up. So do I buy the monk and then use him next turn to get 2 wood? That's not a bad deal, but it's going to cost me 2 wood to get him. So really, I'm only breaking even the first turn. Question is then, do I use him in a future turn to get it as a source of 2 wood? I mean, that's 2 wood. It's only round one. That's potentially 10 wood over the game. Maybe I go ahead and buy into him. Yeah, let's go ahead and do that. This might be a little bit of a risk, but at least it's one, putting a one die into the guild master, which is a, in region one, so it doesn't cost me any bread. So I'm going to go ahead and buy this guy, the monk. Cost me 2 bread, so now I'm out of bread altogether. So I'm going to have to pay for some bread later when I have to upkeep my ships. But I can use him next turn, and I just have to make sure I don't forget to get my 2 bread back. So I'm going to end my turn, and now blue has to pass. They don't have any other options available to them. So the question is, do they give up the opportunity to choose the first set of dice next turn? Because they know that I want this spot to get another ship out to get some more points. Or do they want to have first choice on the dice? Now, you never know how the dice are going to roll in this game. That's one of the nice unexpected things, the nice source of randomness, because it could be a 3-3 and a 3 and a 1-1 and a 1. There's a better chance that the dice are going to be radically different than there is a chance that the dice are going to be radically the same. So I think I'm going to go here, which is move a guy into the city. That allows me to pass in this spot and pretty much, I think, guarantee. I mean, yes, I'm potentially giving up first a starting player position if red surprises me and goes up here to get 2 bucks. But I think I'm going to pass here. Now, I can either gain $3 by passing here, or I move one of my workers to an empty city spot. I think I'm going to go there. And I am going to give up the $3 and perform the action. So I got a point because that was either get $3 or score a point and move a guy into the city area. Now, I have plenty of workers in my supply. I'm not paying for too many, and I've got a supply of bread, so I'm not in jeopardy there. So I think I'm going to take a worker from the supply, and I think for now I'm going to drop him into the Wood City, because notice the Wood City now, because of what Red did, has 2 more city spots open. I'm going to grab this rightmost city spot. Remember, the rightmost, just in case, and the rightmost comes into play if there's a tie and you're trying to aim for majority, because the guy who is, in the case of a tie, the guy who has a worker, the player who has a worker in the rightmost city spot breaks the tie for majority. So, for what it's worth, I'm going to grab the majority now in the Wood City, even though I'm not paying, I don't have a King's request for the city, so it doesn't really affect me yet. And for that matter, neither does Red. So I've now gotten my benefit for passing. Now Red is going to do the same thing because he's out of actions. Remember, he wants to use this guild favor, so he's going to use this guy to gain 2 wood. And so Red gets an extra 2 wood, gets 2 wood back from what he paid for the guy to begin with. And now he is going to go ahead and pass in the fourth position to get another ship out. So yes, I am going to do this, and I'm going to grab a ship from my supply, and I have 4 wheat to sell, so I'm going to go down here, sell 4 wheat for $12. Oops, wrong place, sorry. Grab my ship again, put them here, that's the place I can go in a 2-player game, and then I'm selling 4 wheat, which cost me a wood for my ship. But now I've got 3 ships down there, and I'll earn the maximum amount of points that I can for my market route King's request. Okay, so my turn is over. I now have to, I've effectively passed. And now when I click end turn, we're going to leave phase B and go into phase C, which is the building actions phase. Now the building actions phase is resolved in reverse building order. So you start down here and you go this way counterclockwise around. So when as soon as I click end turn, this is the first building that's going to get resolved, and only the blue player has an action marker here, because only the blue player played a guild die. Remember, the blue player has lots of money too. So they've got 3 buildings they're in that they're going to potentially have to pay for or take pirates for. It all depends upon how the dice roll. Remember, here there are 2 guild dice, so the price is going to be a little bit less, chances are, but we don't know yet what the price is going to be until we get there. So let's end the turn. The dice get re-rolled, and a 2 came up on the guild die, which means 8 minus 2 makes the building action price 6. And by the way, in a 3-player game, you compute the building action price by doing 9 minus the number of guild dice, the value on the guild dice. And in a 4-player game, it's 10 minus the value of the guild dice. $6 is about average. It's about what we kind of expected to pay on average here, because it was either 6, 5, or 7. Now, remember I said I have 3 buildings that I'm potentially paying for or taking pirates for. And this one's going to have possibly the cheapest price because there's 2 guild dice here. I have $10 to spend effectively because I want to make sure I have $15 left for my 15 points at the end of this round. And so if I'm paying 6 here, oh boy. Well, I guess it's better than taking 3 pirates, because remember, if you don't pay the price, you get 2, the amount of pirates equal to the pirate die plus 1. So it's either $6. And since I do have 1 worker in region 2, I will be able to gain 2 bread. So yes, I am going to perform the building action, and that's going to get me 2 bread. So now my bread supply is up to 5. But my money is down to 19. Okay, now we move into this building, which is going to give a similar choice to Red. Okay, so Red now has to pay $6 to take the building action, which will get them a point, and that will then tie the score up, for at least now, for the time being, and it will give them the ability to move somebody new into the cities, which Blue already did. And he doesn't need cash in order to fulfill a King's request, so he is going to go ahead and pay the $6. He got a point, so it's now 1-1. But remember, Blue's going to get that 4 points later for having the majority in the City Watch. And now I'm going to move a worker, and let me compute the bread. If I move one more worker, that's 8 workers on the board. 8 bread that I have to pay, 3 of which is coming from the windmill. I'm going to have to pay 2 pirates because I'm going to be short of bread. So the other option is to move one of my workers. Right now I'm already out pirates because I'm going to be short 1 bread. But my other option is to move a guy from someplace else. So maybe I move one of these workers. I don't want to move this worker, obviously, because I need him. Well, actually, no. I would have performed the building action already. So it only affects next turn. I think I want to leave him because I have 4 workers up here now. So for the time being, I think I'm going to grab this worker since I'm already in the King's Forest. I don't need this wood, and I'm already in a wheat field. I'm going to take this worker and drop him into, well, I need bread and I need wood. I'm going to drop him into the wood city. So I'll go put him in this spot here. Okay. Next. Ooh. Cost of 70 is this building. Move 1 to 2 workers to the colonies for ship points. Oh, I can't perform the action because I don't have any red. This is red because red is the only guy who played here earlier. But I don't have any workers in this region, so I'm basically paying 7 bucks or taking 1 pirate for doing nothing. That's a pretty steep price. I think it's going to be easier to get rid of that pirate, and it's not going to be the first pirate I probably have to take, so I'm going to go ahead and click no and take the pirate. So that's 16 points it's costing me, but there's plenty of game left. Okay, Blue has this option, and they don't have any guild favors to turn face up, so they are paying either $6 or taking on 4 pirates. Huh. And if they pay the $6, their supply goes down to 13. And now they're not getting the maximum amount of points they can from their king's request. However, they are over here, and this allows them to move workers to the city watch. And every time you move a worker to the city watch, you get rid of 3 pirates. So, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and do this. I'm going to go take the pirates here, hoping that I can plan on getting rid of some of the pirates when we get to the next building. So 4 pirates. And as expected, things aren't too bad here. The building cost is only $3, or 1 pirate, because there are no pirates in this building. But I'm going to go ahead and pay the $3. Oh, shoot. Oh, yes, I do have a worker here. So it will allow me to move 1 guy to the city watch, and then I'll be able to discard pirates. So I'm going to say, yes, I'm going to pay the $3. It'll take my money supply down to 16, but more than enough to get my 15 points later. And now I can move a worker into the city watch. And again, the question is, where do I want to move them from? I've got 5 workers on the, if I move from the supply, basically I'm going to have 6 workers on the board. That's 6 bread minus 3 in the windmill. That's 3 bread. I've got 5 bread. I'm going to take the worker from the supply, move him into the city watch. And now I've got 2 guys in the city watch. And my pirate count goes from 4 to 1. Not a bad deal. Now, Red has to do this, has to decide as well. Does he pay $3 or take 1 pirate? And does he want to move a guy into the city watch? Well, he doesn't have, yeah, I guess he will. He has a pirate, so he'll be able to get rid of the pirate, and it'll allow him to use pirate dice next turn. Remember, you need guys in the city watch to use the pirate dice. So, yes. And now, where's that worker going to come from is the question. Let's do this calculation again. If I have 8 workers on the city, 8 workers on the board, that's 8 bread minus 3 in the windmill is 5, and I only have 3, so I'm taking pirates later. I'm taking pirates because I'm going to run out of bread one way or another. But it's 1 pirate per piece of bread. And certainly moving down on the windmill to get a piece of bread doesn't help, because remember the windmill is used. That benefit to get bread, using the windmill to get bread, is really only so that you can place low dice on high valued characters to perform their character actions. I guess I'm going to end up having to take the pirate, so I'm going to go ahead and move the guy from my supply into the city watch. And I missed. Okay. All right. That's the last building. We're going to now move into phase D, the maintenance phase. And 4 things happen in the maintenance phase. First, the player who has the majority in the city watch gets 4 points. So that's going to be blue, as expected. Secondly, anybody who has workers in the colony lands area here gets a point, gets a good for each one of those workers, either a wheat, a sugar, or a wine. Nobody's got workers there, so that's not going to earn anybody any workers. And then we'll have to pay wood for upkeep and pay bread for feeding. So let's go on and move into phase D. Blue's got the majority. Now, one of the prices to getting the 4 points is that you've got to give up one of the workers. But he is going to do that to get on the scoreboard and take the lead. So now it's tied in the city watch, but the score is 5-1 in favor of Blue. And now Blue has to pay for upkeep. They have to pay 2 wood. They've got 3 wood to their name. They're in good shape here, so they're just going to go ahead and pay the 2 wood they have. Red's got to pay 3 wood for ship upkeep, but they only have 1 wood. And they have to, they can still buy wood, or they can take pirates. That's the choice. And I think I've got a big supply of wood, so I think I will pay 1 wood out of my supply. It's going to cost me 3 bucks, but I don't need money. So I'm going to take 1 wood out of my supply. And now the other 2 wood I'm going to have to buy, and I'll just buy them. I'll buy 1 up here to get access to my grapes. And I'll buy 1 from the King's Forest. And now I have to pay $3, and I'll simply end my turn, and that's going to cause the $3 to come out, and I'm down to 15 bucks. Okay, so bread. You must now pay 2 bread in order to feed your 5 workers, because 3 of the bread, remember, is coming from the windmill. So bread can take a pirate if they just don't want to pay out the bread, but they've got plenty of bread, so they're just going to go ahead and spend it and pay the bread they need to feed the workers. Now Red has to take 2 pirates because they're missing 2 bread altogether, and they have no way of getting bread at this point. They've got 8 pirate. They've got 8 workers on the board. They only have 3. They're on step 3 of the windmill, so that's 5 bread they have to pay. But they only have 3 bread to their name, so they're taking 2 pirates no matter what. So we're going to click this message. They get the 2 pirates, and now they have the option of paying the 3 bread that they have to feed the workers, or taking a pirate for any bread that they don't want to pay. And I think that I will go ahead and just not take any more pirates, because I already have 2. So I'm just going to pay all the bread. And now it's phase E, the phase we've been waiting for, the King's Request phase, or the Crown's Requests. I guess the game calls it Crown's Requests, and my program calls them King's Requests, whatever the case may be. Blue has only 1 type of King's Request. It's the one they were counting on. It has a value of 15, meaning they have $15 to spend. They're going to get 15 points from the King for prestige, so their score is going to go up to 20. Now, they do have the option of scoring fewer than 15 points, but they're just going to take all 15 points. And so it's now 20-1, but let's not rule out the red player. The red player has three ships down here in the market route area. They're going to get 4 points for this ship. They're going to get 6 points for this ship. That's 10. They're going to get 3 points for this ship. That's 13. So not quite as good as red, as blue, rather. And so blue is going to have a lead going into round two. And so here we are in round two, phase A, where blue has first dibs on the dice. And the dice are pretty similar to what they were last time. A 2-1-1 and a 2-2-1, I think. But still no threes, and only 1-3 on the pirate dice, just the way the dice rolled. So blue, remember, he doesn't have any guild favors, so he doesn't have to worry about flipping over any guilds. If he takes these dice, the better of the two sets of dice, he'll get first player order, and then he has to take one of these king's requests or crown's requests. So he's going to take the best dice, and he's going to grab this king's request, which is the one that red just scored for, and blue is already in has two ships down there, so he's in good shape going in. So he's going to grab that one. And now red is now in second place, second turn order, and does he go for a money one? He's got this, he already has an expeditions one. Maybe he needs to do some catch up. But the best he can do here is 15. The best he can do here is 15. He could potentially do 18. How's his supply of grapes? He's in one grape field. And here's the harvester over here. He could potentially get three grapes. His options are open. I'm going to grab the money, king's request, but maybe I'll play into the colony lands. I'm not sure. Into the colonies. So anyway, we're going to grab that one. And now it is the beginning of round two, phase B, the character actions again. And I guess I could end it here, because we've pretty much covered everything there is to cover. So the only thing that's going to happen now that we haven't talked about is that at the end of this round, at the end of this round in phase E, there are no king's requests to have to resolve, but any any convertible wheat fields are going to convert to sugar at this time, at the end of this round. Now, there are not currently any convertible wheat fields that are visible. But there's nobody over here to take the wood that's covering this convertible wheat field. So it's possible that this field is never going to get converted to sugar. But that's what happens at the end of round two. At the end of round three, remember, the players have to resolve two of their king's requests. They'll have another one from next round. So they'll have three king's requests to choose from, two of which they score and surrender. In round four, any convertible wine fields, and there is one, convertible sugar fields, rather. There is one over here, and there may be another one will turn up, will convert to wine before the game ends at the end of round four. And in the end of round five, when the game ends, all players have to surrender all of their king's requests, score them for whatever they can, and take them home with them. Unfortunately, Red, when he took second place, he was able to flip over a red or a purple guild favor, but his guild favor was white, so it's still flipped face down. So he can't use it again unless, wow, he can't use it again. Let's see, the only way to flip over a guild favor during the game, I mean, you can do it during the building action phase here, but then, I think, is it too late to use a guild favor? When can you use guild favors? I think you can use them in B and C. Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can. This guild favor is inactive because you can only use a guild favor at the very beginning of phases B and C. Well, actually, that's technically wrong. You can only use a guild favor at the very, I think it's at the very beginning of a turn in phase B, or at the very beginning of a turn in phase C. My tooltip is wrong. So that's incorrect. And also, why is it all the way up there instead of down here where I'm hovering? Whatever the case may be, I can fix all that. But anyway, what's the other thing I wanted to fix? I can't remember now. That's just great. So I do have to fix the guild favorite tooltip, which is not the end of the world. But anyway, sorry about that. You've seen most of the game. The other thing that happens at the end of the game, of course, is the player with the most pirates loses 16 points, if there is a player that has any pirates at all. So you saw that there is an ability to get rid of pirates. There is plenty of ability to gain pirates. But we pretty much cover the entire game. So we're in now round two. You've seen that the harvester tile moves to the second building and the other ones get randomized. So now all the buildings are in pretty much different places. I guess the mayor is still over here, random, because it just happened to turn out that way. The building actions are the building actions. They don't change, obviously. The maintenance phase is the same. So you've pretty much seen it all. I hope that has allayed any fears you might have had about Madeira. I hope it's interested you in the game. It is not a difficult game to get the hang of, but making the decisions are really tricky, as you saw. So, bye-bye.